Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. The list of articles which has been chosen for today's analysis are provided here. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping for the displayed articles is provided in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping is also provided in the comments section. Let's move on to our first article discussion. Our first discussion is based on this news article, which is titled as Right to Property is a Fundamental Right, says Supreme Court. Now, you have to pay attention here because the Supreme Court has not made any such statement in the case law that is mentioned in this news article. The case law is Vidya Devi versus State of Himachal Pradesh. So, in this discussion, we will see the facts regarding the case law with respect to this news article. The syllabus that is relevant for this analysis is given here for your reference. See, the petitioner of this case was Ms. Vidya Devi, who is 80 years old at present. She approached the Supreme Court for a land encroachment that was carried out way back in 1967 to 68. Her private land was taken from her to construct a major district road. So with respect to this, the Supreme Court has noted that the state has taken her land without conducting the required land acquisition proceedings or without following due process of law. Here the law refers to the then Land Acquisition Act, which is called as the Land Acquisition Act of 1894, and also the then constitutional provisions that were available in the constitution with respect to property rights. And with respect to this land encroachment, even Ms. Vidya was not given any compensation by the state for taking the land. So this is the background of this case law. Now let us come to the discussion whether right to property is a fundamental right or not, as mentioned by the heading of this news article. See, the right to property was a fundamental right. If you see the original constitution, it was mentioned that all citizens shall have the right to acquire, hold and dispose of property. And this right was mentioned in Article 19, Clause 1, Subclause F of Indian Constitution. And this right was called as the right to property. In addition to this Article 19, one exclusive article was also present for the right to property. This article was Article 31 of Indian Constitution. And this article stated that no person shall be deprived of his property save by the authority of law. But an important point to note here is that both subclause F of Clause 1 of Article 19 and Article 31 was later omitted or removed from Part 3 or the Fundamental Rights part of Indian Constitution. And that is why we are saying right to property was a fundamental right. And this change or amendment was done by the Constitution, 44th Amendment Act of 1978. So as a result of this, the right to property lost the status of fundamental right. And the same Constitutional Amendment Act made the right to property as a constitutional right under a new article, which is the Article 300, capital A. So as of now, the right to property is not a fundamental right, but it is a constitutional right under Article 300, capital A. And right to property is also a human right of an individual as per international human rights standards. Even the Supreme Court has observed the same in this case law, which is the Ms. Vidya Devi versus State of Himachal Pradesh. But the news article mentions that Supreme Court declared right to property as fundamental right. So remember, Supreme Court did not make any such statement. Rather, Supreme Court just stated that right to property was a fundamental right when the land was taken away from Ms. Vidya in 1967 to 68. However, the right to property lost the fundamental rights status when the 44th Constitutional Amendment Act of 1978 came into force. So this was the comment made by the Supreme Court in this case law. Now with respect to this case law, the state government of Himachal Pradesh stated that it is having the land of Ms. Vidya since 1967 to 68. Therefore, under the principle of adverse possession, the land belongs to the state government now. Now this principle of adverse possession means that a person or government is possessing the property, but this person or the government is not the true owner. Now here the state government is mentioning this principle because if a person has a private property under adverse possession for an uninterrupted or continuous period of time, then under various laws, this property could become the property of the claimant, which in our case will be the state government. But this argument of the state government was dismissed by the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court noted that the state cannot be permitted to perfect its title over the land by invoking the doctrine of adverse possession to grab the property of its own citizens. And at the end, Supreme Court also observed that the state cannot dispossess a citizen of his property except in accordance with the procedure established by law. It even noted that in the present day scenario, to forcibly dispossess a person of his property without following due process of law would be violative of human right, and it will be violative of the constitutional right which is provided under Article 300 capital A of Indian Constitution. Further, the Supreme Court noted that obligation to pay compensation is not explicitly mentioned in Article 300 capital A, but it can be inferred from that article. That is, the Supreme Court is saying that obligation to pay compensation is implicitly mentioned in this article. So the Supreme Court asked the state government to pay the compensation and all statutory benefits, including solatium, interest, etc., within a period of 8 weeks. In addition to this, the state has been directed to pay legal costs and expenses of rupees 10 lakhs to the appellant, who is Ms. Vidya Devi. So these are the information with respect to this case law and right to property. With this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, this news article discusses the outcomes of a UN report named as Levels and Trends in Child Mortality. So in this discussion, we will discuss about the group which develops this report, and then we will see about the outcomes of this report in comparison with India's 2017 sample registration system. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now, this report, that is the Levels and Trends in Child Mortality report, has been developed by the UN Interagency Group for Child Mortality Estimation. This group was formed in 2004, and it was primarily formed to share data on child mortality, to provide methods for child mortality estimation, and then also to report on progress towards child survival goals, and then to enhance every country's capacity to produce timely and properly assessed estimates of child mortality. And this interagency group for child mortality estimation is led by UNICEF, that is United Nations Children's Fund. And it also includes other UN bodies such as World Health Organization, the World Bank Group, and the United Nations Population Division of the Department of Economic and Social Affairs. And these bodies are full members in this interagency group. So this group updates child mortality estimates once in a year after reviewing newly available data and assessing the data quality. So this report contains the latest estimates of child mortality at the country level, regional level, and also at the global level. So this 2019 report presents the latest estimates done by this interagency group for child mortality estimation till 2018. And the estimates are done for the mortality indicators such as neonatal mortality, under 5 mortality, infant mortality, and mortality among children aged 5 to 14 years. And the first is the neonatal mortality. In this, neonatal means the first 28 days of life of a newborn baby. And this is the most vulnerable time for a child's survival. It is because children face the highest risk of dying in their first month of life. So based on this, the neonatal mortality rate means number of deaths of neonatal children per 1,000 live births. The next comes the under 5 mortality rate. And this under 5 mortality rate is the number of deaths between birth of the child and exactly 5 years of age of the child per 1,000 live births. So it is the number of deaths in this time period per 1,000 live births. Next is the infant mortality rate. It is the number of deaths between birth of the child and exactly 1 year of age of the child per 1,000 live births. So when it is between childbirth and exactly 5 years of age, then it is under 5 mortality. When it is between the childbirth and 1 year of age, it is infant mortality rate. The next is the mortality among children aged 5 to 14 years. And this mortality rate is the number of deaths between this age group per 1,000 children aged 5 years. Based on these mortality indicators, this report assesses progress in the reduction of child and young adolescent mortality at the country level, regional level, and at the global levels. So in this context, whenever we discuss about some indicators, try to link them with the Sustainable Development Goals. So with respect to the child mortality, we have a Sustainable Development Goal target, which is target 3.2. And it comes under goal number 3, which is ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all. And under this target 3.2, all countries shall aim to reduce neonatal mortality to at least as low as 12 per 1,000 live births. And in addition to this, all countries shall aim to reduce under 5 mortality to at least as low as 25 per 1,000 live births. So these are the basic details that you should know with respect to this UN report. Now let us discuss the outcomes of this report. If you see the news article compares the estimates of this UN report with India's 2017 sample registration system. See, this sample registration system is a large-scale demographic survey for providing reliable annual estimates of infant mortality rate, birth rate, death rate, and other fertility and mortality indicators at the national and at the subnational levels for our country. And this sample registration system, or the SRS, was initiated on a pilot basis by the Office of Registrar General of India, and it was initiated in few selected states in the year 1964 to 65. But later, it was made fully operational during 1969 to 70. So currently, the SRS provides reliable annual estimates of infant mortality rate, birth rate, death rate, and other fertility and mortality indicators for the year 2017. So now let us see the data based on these two reports. First comes the indicator of under 5 mortality rate. According to the UN report, in 2018, India is among the few countries in the world where the mortality for girls under 5 years of age exceeded the mortality for boys under 5 years of age. So this shows gender disparity in child mortality. Gender disparity mentioned here is nothing but the gender gap. And based on this report, at the national level, India's under 5 mortality rate is 37 as of 2018. And if you see based on the gender of the child, then the under 5 mortality rate for male child is 36. And for female child is 37 for the year 2018. So that is why the news article mentions that the mortality for girls under 5 years of age exceeds that of boys. Not only this, globally if we see, half of all under 5 deaths in 2018 occurred in 5 countries. And among these 5 countries, one is India. And the other countries are Nigeria, then our neighbor Pakistan, then Democratic Republic of Congo, and then Ethiopia. And even among these 5 countries, India and Nigeria alone accounted for about 1/3 of under 5 deaths in 2018 globally. So you can see how severe is the problem of under 5 mortality in India. So these were the estimates given by UN report. Now if you see the sample registration system estimates, at the national level, the under 5 mortality rate is estimated at 37. And these estimates also show a high gender disparity, that is the gender gap in under 5 mortality rate. At the national level, if you see, the female under 5 mortality rate is 39, whereas for male under 5 mortality rate at the national level, it is 36. So you can see the gender gap here. And the highest gender disparity can be seen in states like Jharkhand, Assam and Haryana. And then the state which amounted for the highest under 5 mortality rate is Madhya Pradesh, which had an under 5 mortality rate of 55. And the lowest was seen in the state of Kerala, which had a rate of 12. So this was about the under 5 mortality rate. Next comes the neonatal mortality rate. And according to this UN report, the neonatal mortality rate for India in 2018 was 23. And this rate was same according to the sample registration system also, because according to this estimate, at the national level, the neonatal mortality rate for India is 23 only. And the states with the highest burden of neonatal mortality rate are Madhya Pradesh, Odisha and Uttar Pradesh, which had neonatal mortality rates of 30 and above. And according to the UN report, the major causes of neonatal mortality are the preterm birth, then intrapartum related complications such as lack of breathing at birth, etc. Here the intrapartum means the time period over the childbirth from the onset of labor through delivery of placenta. So this period is called as the intrapartum period. And then other causes for neonatal mortality are infection, then birth defects, etc. Then after this comes the infant mortality rate. And according to the UN report, in 2018, India has an IMR of 30. And according to the SRS, IMR at national level is reported to be 33, which is higher than the UN report. And the state which is having the highest infant mortality rate is again Madhya Pradesh, which had the infant mortality rate of 47. And the lowest is Kerala, having the rate of 10. And this SRS estimate also noted that female infants experienced a higher mortality than the male infants in all states except a few states such as Chhattisgarh, Delhi, Madhya Pradesh, Tamil Nadu and Uttarakhand.
Next comes the mortality among children aged 5 to 14 years. According to the UN report, this rate is at 6 for India in 2018. And according to the SRS estimate, at the national level, the death rate in this age group, that is 5 to 14 age group, is estimated to be 0.6. And the state which has the highest death rate in this age group is the state of Odisha, which has a rate of 1.1. So here we can see that in the year 2018, according to the UN report, the age 5 to 14 mortality rate for India is highest as compared to the SRS estimate for 2017. So from this, we can say that sound policies, concerted efforts and appropriate resources are needed to accelerate the progress, and they are needed to achieve the child survival goals. Now, it is important because globally we have the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which was adopted in 1989, and India got accession to this treaty in 1992. Here, accession is the act whereby a state accepts the offer or the opportunity to become a party to the treaty, which is already negotiated and signed by other states. And when one state gets accession to a particular treaty, then it has the same legal effect as a ratification. So as per this Convention of Rights of the Child, most fundamental of these rights is the right of every child to survive. So protecting every child's right to survive will require addressing the persistent inequities and disparities in the maternal health and child health in India. And at the same time, India needs to ensure universal access to safe, effective and high quality and affordable care for women, children and adolescents so that India can be on the way to meet the SDG targets. So these are the information with respect to this news article and the UN report on the levels and trends in child mortality. With this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is based on this news article, which talks about the second wetland bird survey or the second waterfowl census in the Kaziranga National Park. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, the first waterfowl census in Kaziranga National Park was held in the year 2018. After that, for the second time, this census was conducted recently in this month. And as we know, Kaziranga National Park is in the state of Assam and it is known for Big Four. When we say Big Four, we are referring to the rhinos, elephants, Bengal tigers and Asiatic water buffaloes. In addition to this, the national park is also very important for wetlands and the birds in those wetlands. These birds in wetlands are also referred to as waterfowls. Then this Kaziranga National Park is also an important area for migratory birds. So it is declared as an important bird area in India by the BirdLife International. Then because of its outstanding significance, the Kaziranga National Park was also included in the list of World Heritage Sites by the UNESCO. It was included in 1985 under the natural category. So these were the important points with respect to Kaziranga National Park. Now let us see the data of this waterfowl census based on the news article. The recent waterfowl census has been carried out by the authorities in the Kaziranga National Park and by the avian specialists or the bird specialists. In this waterfowl census, it is found that the park has a total of 19,225 birds, and these birds belong to 96 species under 80 families. And out of these 19,000 birds, more than 45% of the birds belong to the bird family Anatidae. And this Anatidae is a bird family that includes geese, ducks, swans and few other birds. And even the news article mentions some of these birds such as bar-headed geese and teals. Now in this you should note that teals also belong to the family Anatidae. And out of the teals present in our country, the Andaman teal and the large whistling teal are protected under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. And the remaining all other teals come under Schedule 4 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Then if we see among the ducks, two species come under Schedule 1. They are pink-headed duck and white-winged wood duck. Other than these two species of ducks, all other ducks are protected under Schedule 4 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. So this is an additional information that you should know with respect to teals and ducks. Now after this, if you look at the news article, it talks about an important range called as Agorotoli Range in the Kaziranga National Park. Actually, there are four ranges in Kaziranga National Park. One is Agorotoli Range, second one is Bagori Range, then Kohora Range and then Burapahad Range. Now, the census has revealed that more than half of the birds and around 85 species out of the 96 species were recorded in this Agoratoli range. So, what makes this Agoratoli range special? The speciality of this range is because of the presence of Sohola wetland. This wetland is the largest of the 92 perennial wetlands in the Kaziranga National Park. And it is reported that more than 34% of the birds that were counted in the census were found in this Sohola wetland. So now we know that there are 92 perennial wetlands in Kaziranga. In addition to this, there are more than 250 seasonal water bodies in it. And one such important river is called the Polu River, which is running through the national park. This river is known to be the tributary of River Brahmaputra. If you see, in the beginning we saw this is a second wetland bird survey. And now also we saw one another wetland, which is Sohola wetland. So in this context, it becomes important to know about the definition of this term wetland. When we talk about wetlands, there is an intergovernmental treaty that was adopted in Ramsar in Iran. And this intergovernmental treaty is called as the Ramsar Convention on Wetlands. And India is a party to this convention, as we know. And according to this convention, wetlands are areas of marsh, they are areas of fen, peatland or water. In this, fen is a low and marshy or frequently flooded area of land, and peatland is a land which largely consists of peat or peat bogs. So what is a peat? Peat is a dark brown substance like soil that was formed by plants which were dying and becoming buried. Then a wetland could be natural or artificial, it could be permanent or temporary. Then the water in the wetlands could be static or it could be flowing. It could be fresh water, brackish water or salt water. Then wetlands also include areas of marine water where the depth of marine water at the low tide should not exceed 6 meters. Therefore, on a whole, we can say that wetlands include marshes, peatlands, floodplains, rivers and lakes and coastal areas such as salt marshes, mangroves, intertidal mudflats and seagrass beds, and also coral reefs and other marine areas which are not deeper than 6 meters at low tide. And it also includes human-made wetlands such as dams, reservoirs, rice paddy fields, and then wastewater treatment ponds and lagoons. So all these are wetlands according to this Ramsar Convention on Wetlands. So in this discussion, we discussed about some of the important findings of this second waterfowl census. And then we also discussed about the term wetland. With this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, this news article mentions about the stone throwing ritual at the Bojanakonda site, which is a Buddhist site. So in this context of this news article, we will see about the significance of this site in terms of art and architecture. The syllabus that can be linked to this discussion is given here for your reference. The news article mentions that because of Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, that is INTACT campaign, and also by the efforts of government officials, the villagers of Sankaram gave up the ancient practice of throwing stones at Bojanakonda. See, as a part of an ancient ritual, the villagers of this village Sankaram used to throw stones at a belly-shaped object at this heritage site. They used to throw stones believing that the belly shaped object is a part of a demon, and this is done during the Sankranti festival. Now this practice of throwing stones is leading to a cause for continuous damage of this historical heritage site. Therefore, to conserve the site, the members of the INTACT and the government officials convinced the villagers to give up the throwing of stones at Bojanakonda. So in this context, let us see the significance of Bojanakonda and Lingalametta, which are mentioned in this news article. The Bojanakonda and Lingalametta are known as twin Buddhist monasteries. These twin Buddhist monasteries belong to 3rd century BC. These sites are located in Vishakhapatnam district of Andhra Pradesh. And these two sites are known for three forms of Buddhism. They are Theravada, Mahayana and Vajrayana. In the Theravada period, Lord Buddha was considered a teacher. And during the Mahayana period, Buddhism was more devotional. And then in the Vajrayana period, Buddhist tradition was more practiced as Tantra form. It is the form which uses mantras, meditation, yoga and ritual. Now this Tantric form mainly involves self-realization and spiritual enlightenment by following very disciplined practices like yogic practices. And this Vajrayana is also known as esoteric. That is, it is intended for, or it is likely to be understood by only a small number of people with specialized knowledge or interest, or it can be understood only by an enlightened inner circle. So these were the three forms of Buddhism for which these two sites are known for. Now these two sites are known as twin monasteries because of their similarities in terms of art and architecture. And these two Buddhist sites exist on adjacent hillocks near a village called as Sankaram, which is in Vishakhapatnam. And this Bhojanakunda site is famous for many votive stupas. That is, it contains stupas which are dedicated for offering in the fulfillment of a vow. Then this site is famous for rock cut caves. It is famous for brick built edifices or structures. Then it is famous for early historic pottery. And then it is also famous for Satvahana coins that date back to the 1st century AD. Now, in this, the Satvahana are a dynasty who ruled the present Andhra region, and the Satvahanas are contemporary of Mauryas, which means the Satvahanas and Mauryas existed in the same period. Then, the main stupa in this Bhojanakonda site was carved out of rock, and then it is covered with bricks. And then, in this site, a number of images of the Buddha are sculpted on the rock face all over the hill. So this was about the Bhojanakonda site. Now next is the Lingalametta site. In this site, we can see hundreds of rock-cut monolithic stupas in rows. This is the speciality of this site. So from these informations, you can easily see that these are our cultural heritage. So therefore, for recognizing the cultural heritage of these sites, INTAC is demanding UNESCO's heritage site status. Because if World Heritage Site status is given to these sites, then it can be restored and preserved for the future generations. So this was about the news article about the Buddhist sites. Now in this context, let us also know about INTAC from prelims point of view. As we saw earlier, INTAC stands for Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage. It was founded in 1984. It is a private registered society which is registered under the Societies Registration Act of 1860, and it aims to promote the heritage awareness and conservation in India. And this National Trust is also recognized by UNESCO, as it was given the special consultative status by UNESCO in 2007. So that is all about this news article. In this discussion, we discussed about the importance of Buddhist sites like Bhojanakonda and Lingalametta, and then we also discussed about INTAC in brief. With this, we come to the end of this news article discussion. The display practice question will be discussed in the last session. With this, we come to the end of news article discussion session. The next session is the practice questions discussion session. In this question, two statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. The first statement is, right to property is a fundamental right under Part 3 of Indian Constitution. Then the second statement states, the Constitution 44th Amendment Act 1978 has omitted Article 19, Clause 1, Subclause F and Article 31 of Indian Constitution. Now actually, these two are totally contradicting statements, because if you remember, right to property was a fundamental right under Article 19, Clause 1, Subclause F and also under Article 31. So if first statement is correct, that means second statement is wrong. If second statement is correct, then that means first statement is wrong. Now to know whether second statement is correct or not, first you should know whether the 44th Amendment Act omitted these two. Yes, this 44th Amendment Act omitted these two articles, and these two articles dealt with right to property as a fundamental right. So that means this statement is correct, which means the first statement is wrong. It is wrong because it should be right to property was a fundamental right under Part 3 of Indian Constitution. Part 3 is the fundamental rights. So just remember that after this 44th Amendment, right to property lost the status of fundamental right, and now it is a constitutional right under Article 300 capital A. Because the same 44th Amendment Act made right to property as a constitutional right under this article. So here the question asks for the correct statement. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. Now in this question, again two statements are given. We have to choose the correct statement. The first statement is, under 5 mortality rate is the number of deaths between birth and exactly 5 days of age per 1000 live births. Now this statement is wrong, because under 5 mortality rate is the number of deaths between birth and exactly 5 years of age of the child per 1000 live births. So this statement is wrong. Now, the second statement states India has achieved the SDG target of reducing the under 5 mortality rate. Now, the SDG's target which is mentioned here is target 3.2, which mentions that by 2030, the countries have to end preventable deaths of newborns and children, deaths of children under 5 years of age. And all countries should aim to reduce neonatal mortality to at least as low as 12 per 1000 live births, and under 5 mortality to at least as low as 25 per 1000 live births. Now, this statement would have been correct if India would have achieved this. But if you see the recent 2018 data provided by UN based on its levels and trends in child mortality, the under 5 mortality rate in India is 37. So, that means India did not achieve the SDG target. So, this statement is also wrong. Here, the question asks for the correct statement. But here, both the statements are incorrect. So, the correct answer to this question is neither one nor two. That is, neither first statement is correct nor second statement is correct. Now, this third statement is based on Kaziranga National Park. The first statement states, Sohola Wetland is a part of Kaziranga National Park. Now, this statement is correct. Recently, we saw this Sohola wetland with respect to the second wetland bird survey or the second waterfowl census in Kaziranga National Park, in which it was stated that the Agoratoli range in the Kaziranga National Park has more than half of the birds and 85 species out of the total 96 species. And one of the reasons for more birds in this range is the presence of Sohola wetland. And this Sohola wetland is the largest of the 92 perennial wetlands in Kaziranga National Park. So, the statement is correct. The second statement is the Kaziranga National Park is a UNESCO World Heritage Site under the natural category. Now, this statement is also correct. It was declared as a World Heritage Site in the year 1985 under the natural category. And also remember that from India, we have totally 38 World Heritage Sites. 30 belong to cultural category, 7 belong to natural category, and 1 belong to the mixed category. So, this statement is correct. And here the question asks for the incorrect statement. So, be careful before marking the answer. Here both the statements are correct and none of the statements are incorrect. So, the correct answer to this question is neither 1 nor 2. Now, this next question is a previous year question which appeared in 2019 prelims examination. Three statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. The first statement is, under Ramsar Convention, it is mandatory on the part of the government of India to protect and conserve all the wetlands in the territory of India. Now, this statement is wrong because according to Article 4 of the Ramsar Convention, each contracting party shall promote the conservation of wetlands and waterfowl by establishing nature reserves on wetlands and by providing adequate space for the wandering of the waterfowls. Now, it is not mandatory on the part of the government of India to protect and conserve all the wetlands in the territory of India. So, this statement is wrong. The second statement states, the Wetlands Conservation and Management Rules 2010 were framed by the government of India based on the recommendation of Ramsar Convention. Now, this statement is correct because Article 3 of the Ramsar Convention states that the contracting parties shall formulate and implement their planning so as to promote the conservation of the wetlands included in the list. Now, the third statement states, now, if you know the second statement is correct and the first statement is wrong, you can easily arrive at the answer because if the first statement is wrong, here the question asks for the correct statement. So, you can eliminate option A and D and the second statement is correct. That means from the remaining options, you can easily say statement 3 is obviously correct. So, the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 and 3 only. But let us see why third statement is correct. The Wetlands Conservation and Management Rules 2010 also encompass the drainage area or catchment regions of the wetlands as determined by the authority. This statement is correct because wetland means the area of marsh, fen, peatland or water, and it could be natural or artificial, it could be permanent or temporary, it could have static or flowing water, and the water could be fresh or brackish water or salt water. And it also includes inland waters such as lakes, reservoir, tanks, backwaters, lagoons, estuaries and man-made wetlands, and also the zone of direct influence on wetlands, which is the drainage area or the catchment region of the wetlands. So, this statement is correct based on this. Now, let us see one another question. This question is based on Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, INTAC. And the question asks, which of these statements is incorrect with reference to INTAC? The first statement is, it aims to promote heritage awareness and conservation in India. This statement is correct. This is the objective of INTAC and it was founded in 1984. The second statement states INTAC is an autonomous organization under the Ministry of Culture. Now this statement is wrong because it is a private registered society which was registered under the Societies Registration Act of 1860. So from the options you can say that C is correct and B is incorrect. So the correct answer to this question is option B only. And the last statement is also correct. In 2007, UNESCO granted the special consultative status to INTAC.
With this, we have come to the end of our today's sessions. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates on civil service examination preparation.